may be seated.
All right, we tricked you. You're going to have to turn to 74. Is that the course books? Yeah. Majesty, 74.
Majesty. Anyone that feels like they would like to stand for this song, just feel free to stand up.
It's going to be in your chorus book. It's your chorus book.
His anthem rings.
So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship.
Talk about kingdom authority today that's going to flow from his throne unto his own, you and all, us and all, us and we're going to talk about God's sovereignty again today and talk about that kingdom authority that flows from his throne unto his own. So amen. Thank you for standing.
If you'll turn to 298, we're going to sing all verses in your hymn book.
I
You'll turn your chorus books to 64.
Let's grab a hand of little ones. It's time for them to, yeah, have their church. Grab a hand. Grab a hand. That's only children, remember. All right. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Renee. We ask you to bless her as she instructs and talks to these children about Jesus, and help them like little sponges taking in the love of God in their lives. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
It's time for the reading of the word. We'd like to stand while we do this. It comes to us in Romans, my favorite book. And we're in the ninth chapter, verse 19 to 21. You will say to me, why? Why does he still find fault? Who resisted his will? But indeed, O man, who are you to reply against God? Will a thing formed say to him who formed it, why? Why have you made me like this? Does not the potter have power over the clay from the same lump to make one vessel for honor? Other for dishonor. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for your majesty. We thank you for the songs that we heard. And we realize that you are the king who sits upon the throne, who plays his toys as the galaxies. You are majesty. And so today we ask a special blessing for our pastor as he breaks the bread with us, and bless each of us. We know that the Spirit of Christ is with us here now, and we thank you for it in Christ's name. Amen.
So our theme verse for this year, the goal we have set for ourselves, is to really keep with Jesus' prayer in John 17, verse 3, saying, I pray, Father, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, the one you sent to earth. And that's what we've been trying to do this year. We've been trying to learn more about God, to know God better. And what we've done is said, okay, let's look at some attributes of God. And here we are, the end of May, and we're still looking at the attributes of God, because we will not finish this. Now, we're gonna go until God says whoa. Go till he says whoa. But right now, I want you to realize we're scratching the surface of something that will take you a lifetime and eternity to know the attributes of God. So, today, our opening verse, Brother Ed read it to us, but before we jump right into the version I'm going to read you, I want us to just kind of recap. Last week, Memorial Weekend, it was Memorial Sunday here at our church. We show a slideshow of people who have gone on before, those people that have influenced our lives and made us who we are, that God has used to shape us. And we left with, I'm hoping, the idea to take a new grip, because God's mercy has come down through generations upon generations, that we have such a huge crowd of witnesses to the faith that God is encouraging you to continue to run that race with endurance. Monday was our National Day of Prayer by proclamation of our president for Memorial Day. At 11 o'clock, we prayed. And then chaos, literally chaos. The world went into chaos. Now, Brother Graham, Franklin Graham, has called the church to pray today. I don't know if we're ready to. Pray. Every pulpit is saying pray. Pray for our country. Pray for our leaders. But not only every pulpit, every scripture tells us to pray for our leaders. Democrat or Republican, pray for your leaders. Or Libertarian, or don't tread on me, whatever. The thing is, as I was considering where we were going with this, and I know we've already talked about God's sovereignty. We have. The last time we looked at sovereignty, we saw that God's got the world events in his control. That he is sovereign over his church and sovereign over my life. I know God is sovereign. All-powerful. He's possessing supreme and ultimate power. But now in the light of this week, I'm going, So, let's talk about sovereignty again. Because we can't lose hope. So, let's look at Romans 9:19 through 21. Brother Ed read it to us, but I'm going to read it now out of the New Living. The reason I'm reading out of the New Living is very conversational. Somebody asked me one time whether I was King James only. I do a lot of reading out of the King James. It's right here, sitting right beside me, just because this is my whoopee. This is the one that makes me feel good. This is the one I study out of, and it just sits here right beside me in case I need it. But this is one I read out of for you all. And I had a great Dr. McGee was asked one time, what's the most reliable, what's the best Bible to buy and read? And he says, the best Bible, the best version to use is the one that you'll read. So, I'm not too caught up in whether or not this is the King James Version or not, because I know we can find what we need in any version. So here we go. Romans 9:19 through 21 says, well then, you might say, why does God blame people for not responding? Haven't they simply done what he makes them do? No, don't say that. Who are you, a mere human, to argue with God? Should the thing that was created say to the one who created it, why have you made me like this? When a potter makes jars out of clay, doesn't he have the right to use the same lump of clay to make one jar for decoration and another to throw garbage in? That's our opening text. And in your bulletin, what I want you to put in there is, who are you to argue with God? Who are you to argue with God? So one of the things that I was looking at this week, and I was thinking about when we started studying this idea of sovereignty, is you know what I found out? Sovereignty doesn't mean, does not equal good times. Sovereignty does not mean everything's going to be just peachy keen in my life. Sometimes sovereignty can be hard. So, look at Exodus chapter 5. Exodus chapter 5. Let's do a little backstory. In chapter 3, God comes down to Moses in a burning bush and says, I've heard my people's cry. I have come down to deliver them. And I am that I am, and take off your shoes, and this is hallowed ground, and this is what you're going to do, and I can't do it. And yes, you can. No, I can't. Okay, your brother can speak for you. Put your hand in, pull your hand out, all of these things. And then in chapter 5, after doing exactly what God told him to do, in chapter 5, verses 4 through 9, Pharaoh replies, Moses and Aaron, why are you distracting the people from their tasks? Get back to work. Look, there are many of your people in the land, and you are stopping them from their work. That same day, Pharaoh sent his order to the Egyptian slave drivers and the Israelite foremen. Do not supply any more straw for making bricks. Make the people get it themselves, but still require them to make the same number of bricks as before. Don't reduce the quota. They are lazy. That's what they are crying. That's why they are crying out, let us go and offer sacrifices to our God. Load them down with more work. Make them sweat. That'll teach them to listen to lies. God in his sovereignty told Moses and Aaron to go to let my people go. And what happened? People suffered. God's sovereignty isn't always pleasant. But God's sovereignty in Exodus, this whole story of the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, this whole story of 10 plagues and death, destruction, a disease, was all for a purpose. In Exodus chapter 7, verse 5, God says, when I raise my powerful hand and bring out the Israelites, the Egyptians will know that I am Jehovah. In Exodus 29, verse 46, right when the children of Israel are setting up their camp and they've been freed from Egypt, he says, and they will know that I am Jehovah their God. I am the one who brought them out of the land of Egypt so that I could live among them. I am Jehovah their God. All of that to show them that he is God, Jehovah. 10 plagues. But what else did we get out of it? We get out of it the Passover. We get the plan of salvation laid out perfectly. Blood put on a doorpost and lintel. The Passover lamb slain. The unleavened bread made. The bitter herbs eaten. Perfectly laying out the plan of redemption. But it wasn't fun. It was not fun. If you, even you, an Israelite, didn't put blood on your doorpost and lintel, your firstborn died. The firstborn in the land of Egypt and the land of Goshen died because of God's sovereign will. Sovereignty doesn't mean everything is going to be peachy keen. Look at Daniel chapter chapter 1. Daniel chapter 1. 1 through 3. During the third king of King Jehoiakim's reign in Judah, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon came to Jerusalem and asked them to come quietly with him. No, he besieged it. The Lord gave him victory over the king Jehoiakim of Judah and permitted him to take some of the sacred objects from the temple of God. He actually went into the temple of God and took some of the sacred items. And what did he do with them? He took them back to the land of Babylonia and placed them in the treasure house of his God. Guess what Isaiah and Jeremiah spend all their time doing? Telling them, the people of Israel, this is going to happen. They spend their entire life warning that God is going to send his armies to take them away to captivity, and it's Nebuchadnezzar that does it. Do you suppose when Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians were laying siege to Jerusalem that some people died? Good people? Bad people? Was it God's sovereignty that Nebuchadnezzar was come to siege Jerusalem? Yep. Sovereignty does not mean that everything's going to be peachy keen. Lamentations, which is poor old Jeremiah, he just can't take it anymore, and he just starts lamenting. In fact, he writes a whole book about lamenting. And this is how he talks about Jerusalem. Jerusalem, once so full of people, is now deserted. She who was once great among the nations now sits alone like a widow. Once the queen of the earth, she is now a slave. She sobs through the night. Tears stream down her cheeks. Among all her lovers, there's no one left to comfort her. All her friends have betrayed her and become her enemies. She's a widow, and she's lost. She's a widow, and she's a slave. Doesn't sound like God's sovereignty is all that great for Jerusalem. But what happens because of this? The book of Daniel, written during this time of great siege, gives us the two of the three greatest timelines in history. Two of the three greatest timelines. We have the timeline of the Gentiles. We have the timeline of the Jews. Amazing, amazing timelines. God laid them out to Daniel. Miracles, visions. That's God's sovereignty. But it wasn't all peachy keen. There was suffering in God's sovereignty. Acts 7. Acts 7. 59 and 60. This is the story of Stephen. If you want to read about Stephen, he's a guy who likes to serve tables, make sure that things are, all the people's needs are being met. In Acts chapter 6, you figure out where he gets picked. And then in chapter 7, you see the story about him. And man, he becomes quite a preacher. But then in verse 59, he has given such a strong message that the Jewish leaders have come to the point where they rent their clothes and they stone him for his message. As they stoned him, Stephen prayed, "Lord, receive my spirit." He fell to his knees shouting, "Lord, don't charge them with this sin." And with that, he died. There we start seeing the beginning of the martyrdom of the Christian church. God's sovereignty. What happens as a result of the martyrdom of the church? It's like you stepped on a hot fire and it just spread throughout the land. People were not safe in Jerusalem. Then they weren't safe there, and then they weren't safe there, and they just kept moving and moving and moving, moving, taking the gospel with them. People died. Good people. Young people. Old people. Maybe even babies. Maybe even God-fearing people. Down through the ages, we go clear back to Exodus and clear up to the New Testament. Even now, good people die. But God's still sovereign. So this is what I had to come to. Proverbs 3:5-8. Proverbs 3:5-8. You probably have heard this at least once in your lifetime. Maybe some of you have memorized it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths, or he will show you which path to take. Oh, and I filled it in, didn't he? He will show you which path to take. The word was supposed to be show, and I just got so excited I had to type it. And he will show you which path to take. And then it goes on to say, don't be wise in your own eyes, or don't be impressed with your own wisdom. Instead, fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Then you will have a healing for your body and strength for your bones. And the reason I picked this is, what happens if I don't? Let me read it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Okay, I will. Lean not on your own understanding. Okay, I won't. Seek his will in all I do. I will do that. And he will direct or show you which way to go. But what happens if I don't trust in the Lord with all my heart? And I do depend on my own understanding. And I don't seek him in all I do. Will he still direct my paths? Is God still sovereign? We have got to come to some kind of understanding between God's sovereignty and our free will. Okay, I'm going to read something. This is from Michael Houdman. He's an apologist. I've been reading a lot of his stuff lately. And he has a pretty good take on this. He says, the fact that God is sovereign essentially means that he has the power, wisdom, and authority to do anything he chooses within his creation. Amen? Whether or not he actually exerts that control in any given circumstance is actually a completely different question. Often, the concept of divine sovereignty is oversimplified. We tend to assume that if God is not directly, overtly, and purposefully driving some event, then he is somehow not sovereign. The cartoon version of sovereignty depicts a God who must do anything that he can do. Can I read that again? The cartoon version of sovereignty depicts a God who must do anything that he can do, or else he's not truly sovereign. If God is really God, why is there so much suffering in this world? You hear it all the time. The cartoon version. Of course, such a cartoonish view of God's sovereignty is logically false. If a man were to put an ant in a bowl, okay, got the picture? An ant in a bowl. The sovereignty of the man over the ant is not in doubt. The ant may try to crawl out, and the man may not want this to happen. But the man is not forced to crush the ant, drown it, or pick it up. The man, for reasons of his own, may choose to let the ant crawl away, but the man is still in control. There's a difference between allowing the ant to leave the bowl and helplessly watching as it escapes. The cartoon version of God's sovereignty implies that if a man is not actively holding the ant inside the bowl, then he must be unable to keep it in there at all. The illustration of the man and the ant is at least a vague parallel to God's sovereignty over mankind. God has the ability to do anything, to take action and intervene in any situation, but he often chooses to act indirectly or to allow certain things for reasons of his own. His will is furthered in any case. God's sovereignty means that he is absolute in authority and unrestricted in his supremacy. Everything that happens is, at very least, the results of God's permissive will. This holds true even if certain specific things are not what he would prefer. The right of God to allow mankind's free choices is just as necessary for true sovereignty as his ability to enact his will whenever and however he chooses. See, I think of Jonah. Jonah was told to go to Nineveh. Did he? Nope. He got on a boat and went the other way. And what happened? He, in Jonah 1:12, I'll read it to you. It's not easy to find. Jonah 1:12 says, once the storm comes up and the sailors are getting scared that the boat's going to go down, Jonah comes up and says, throw me into the sea. It will become calm again. I know that this terrible storm is all my fault. See, he chose not to do what God told him to do. And there was a fish prepared. And on to Nineveh he went. And guess what? God's perfect will was carried out. Then there's Acts chapter 27. Acts 27. Verse 10, this is Paul. He's getting on a boat, sailing to Rome. He says, men, he said, I believe there's trouble ahead if we go on. Shipwreck, loss of cargo, and danger to all our lives as well. But they didn't listen. And now in verse 21, it says, no one had eaten in a long time. Finally, Paul called the crew together and said, men, you should have listened to me in the first place and left Crete. You would have avoided all this damage and loss. But take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. For last night, an angel of God, to whom I belong, For last night, an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me. And he said, don't be afraid, Paul, for you will surely stand trial before Caesar. Wow, isn't that comforting? What's more, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone sailing with you. So take courage, for I believe God. It will be just as he said, but we will be shipwrecked on an island. See, it's not always good. But God is sovereign. So there's three principles I see here with God's sovereignty. God's sovereignty. Three things I want you to take away today. First, Galatians 6, pretty famous verse. As soon as you hear it, you'll recognize it. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. Don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. God will not be mocked. You will reap what you sow. You will always harvest what you plant. See, there is this law of reaping and sowing. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature, but those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting fruit from the Spirit. See, there is consequences to your choices. You will reap what you sow. Your choices. You will reap from what you sow. In sovereignty, God has made that law that you will reap what you sow. Pharaoh will reap what he sows. Nebuchadnezzar ate grass like a cow for what he did. He ate grass like a cow, like a wild beast out there eating grass. The head of gold, the pinnacle of the Gentile timeline, eats grass like a cow, only to finally come to God is God of the universe. Acts 7, those men who stoned Stephen, they lost the temple. It's gone. 70 years, they were out of work. They reaped what they sowed. The second thing I know about God's sovereignty and free will is found in Romans 8, 28. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. Even when bad people around us, even when a whole bunch of ants are in that bowl that God put us in, and those ants start fighting each other and fighting each other. Overall, I know that God, the sovereign God, will make all things work together for good for the ants that are called according to his purpose. I can take trust in that. Even when there's a Republican president even if there's a Democrat president. God is going to work all things together for good. Isn't that what we said when we looked at sovereignty in the first place? It should level us out a little bit. Not everything has to be a disaster or a celebration. Everything is just going to work together for good. Even our bad choices, God will work together for good. And the last thing I see about God in his sovereignty and free will is Romans 10:13, which says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." That's your choice, to call on the name of the Lord. I'm taking comfort in the fact that God in his sovereignty and God in his omniscience will not be surprised at the rapture and go, "Whoo, you made it? Ha, didn't figure on that one." When he's out there sorting sheep and goats and he goes, "Wow, whoo, that was close, wasn't it? Didn't know if you're going to make it." God is sovereign. He knows the beginning from the end. There is no beginning and end with God. See, here we are talking about God like some human with a beginning and end. No such thing. See, we're just scratching the surface. Doesn't that fit the ant scenario a little better? Here we are, little ants, trying to explain a sovereign God. But I know he's not going to be surprised at judgment. He's not going to be surprised at the rapture of the church. Say, "Whew, I didn't figure you'd make it." So, I'm going to end with this. Corinthians 6. If we know who all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved, then it's time to start calling. As God's partners, or as we work together, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, "At just the right time I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. Choose this day whom you will serve." Choose it. It's your choice. God in his sovereignty, who brought you to Mansfield, Washington, so you can hear a message on sovereignty. A message on sovereignty and your choice. So, this is the thing. We're going to sing "We Bow Down." We're going to come up. I'm going to invite Les and Pat to come. "We Bow Down," chorus 162. But this song, 162 in the chorus books? 64, I don't know why. I need a secretary. Is it 162? Goodness. It's 162, "We Bow Down." So, this is the thing. this song really talks to the sovereignty of God. You are Lord of creation, Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea. You were Lord of the heaven before there was time, and Lord of the Lords you will be. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. Lord of all lords you will be. Our choice. So right now, I want this song not to just be a song of close. Well, that was nice. Nice sermon. Nice preaching, Pastor. Thank you. Got my notes, and they were not all great, but got them in there. I want you to take time. This song is a call to repentance. You make bad choices, stop it. For goodness sake, stop. It's a call to prayer. We've been talking about praying for our nation. Pray. Pray for God's sovereign will to be done in the United States of America. Well, let's just start with Mansfield. And then we can maybe Bridgeport, out at St. Andrews. We can work our way around the state. How about that? Maybe we even go down the hill into Chelan. Right? Then pray for our county. Pray for Waterville. Pray for Withrow. Pray. And most of all, I want you to consider, if you haven't made the choice, to call on the name of the Lord and be saved, today's the day of salvation. Call on the name of the Lord and be saved. So, we're going to sing this song. If you'd like to come up and pray, come up and pray. If you want to have somebody pray with you, bring them with you. Or I'd be happy to. But let's, as we close our service, and we close this time, let's respect this time, and let this be a time of repentance, prayer, possibly salvation. And we'll sing this together, and then we'll pray. You are
Lord of creation and Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea. You were Lord of the heaven before there was time, Lord. We bow down and we
recognize your sovereignty, and we look to the responsibility of our responsibility to choose. So today, Lord, I pray that we will live a life of repentance and humility, that we'll live a life of prayer, and that today we'll take advantage.